In many cases, writing Rust code doesn't require us to use highly advanced type system features or incomplete unstable features from Rust Nightly. It can, however, be super fun to enable some of these features and see what they can do for us, even if those use cases aren't even real world. So today we have one of those use cases in front of us. This is effectively a function implementation that defines its own struct and its own impl for the new and call functions, and only lets you call it some number of times. And it does this through using const generics. So let's take a dive in and see what it actually does. We have to start off with, of course, cargo run, which will tell us that the features we're trying to use, in this case, generic const expressions, isn't allowed to be used on the stable channel. And that's kind of a gating mechanism to make sure that people who write Rust day to day don't end up accidentally depending on incomplete or in progress features. But we can easily get around that by doing cargo plus nightly run, in which case we get the function, which is called three times and outputs high each time. So let's check out the usage of this function first. FNN, or function n, or however you want to pronounce that, uses const generics to say that we can only call this function three times. So here's our first call, here's our second call, and here's our third call. So when you see f.call here, you can kind of replace it in the back of your head as something that's kind of like this, but with just these nightly features, we can't achieve that sort of developer experience. So we have this function called call that is calling this function for us. We can see that if we enable a fourth call and we do a nightly run again, it doesn't compile. And that's because the const generic expression that we are using to enable the feature of only being able to call this function a certain number of times is depending on the fact that this number, when subtracted from itself each time we call, will eventually overflow or underflow. Basically, this number is defined as a U32. So if we get down to zero and we try to subtract from zero, there's nothing below zero inside of a U32. And thus at compile time, because this is const generics, the Rust compiler will note that, hey, this can't happen, and it'll prevent us from calling it a fourth time. So what we've done here is not actually made a function that can only be called three times. We have made a function that will cause a compiler error, which happens to be an overflow error if we try to call it four times. And if we want to look more at that error, we can do a Rust with an explain. And it says a constant value failed to get evaluated. This error indicates that the compiler was unable to sensibly evaluate a constant expression that had to be evaluated, such as attempting to divide by zero or causing an integer overflow. And we are causing an integer overflow. So let's dive in and figure out how this works. We have this struct, fn, capital N, that takes a number of generic arguments, one of which is a const generic called n, that is a U32. This is the number that we're going to subtract to or subtract from. And then we have a generic for the arguments that our function is going to take in, the return value type that we're going to return back, as well as a generic for a function that takes in the arguments and returns the return value. We store the function type in the function field, and then we use phantom data. Now, phantom data isn't an actual thing, for lack of a better term. If you've ever used phantom types, you'll know that a phantom type is never used inside of the type, but it's used to kind of give additional hints to the compiler. This is the same kind of thing. So because in Rust, if we pass in a type that is never used, the Rust compiler usually tries to complain about that and let us know. This is kind of like a fake way to use this type to satisfy the compiler's wants. And then DYN means that we are going to dynamically dispatch this trait object. So that means at runtime, we're going to decide what function is actually going to be called to satisfy this. So you'll see in our implementation that we never actually use p because we're throwing it away intentionally, which brings us to the implementation. So we define two functions here. One is new and one is call. The impl block takes all of the same generics that we saw earlier and organizes them as fnn narf, which reminds me of Pinky and the Brain. So our new function on the fnn struct takes this f type, this function that accepts some arguments and gives us back some return type. If we look down at our usage, we can see that fnn new accepts, in this case, a unit. So it doesn't accept anything, which is why we pass in unit when we call it later, and then does a print line of hi. So there is no, well, not to say there is no return value, but the argument that we're passing in and the value that we're returning from this function are both unit. So we've returned that struct because that struct needs to exist. We do have to fill out p, but we aren't actually ever going to do anything with it. So we just use default, and we keep that function around. Now the magic happens when we use call. The call function takes the arguments that we're going to pass in. So the arguments that we've defined as the generics on this fnn type, which in this case, when we specify it down in our usage, is inferred. That's what the underscore means. The call function returns another fnn, but this time we're returning an fnn with a generic n parameter of n minus 1. So because this is all const generics, this is happening at compile time, which means that when we call call and we passed in 3 the first time, what we're going to get back from this call function is going to be an fnn, but instead of having a 3 here, it's going to have a 2 here. So it can only be called 2 more times. So then because we've stored this function in our struct, we get to call that function with the arguments that we've passed in, and we store the return value of that in the response. In this case, we're returning unit, so it's not super interesting to see the response type, which is why we don't use it in any of our function calls down here. And then we construct a new fnn, so a new function n with a type of n minus 1, like we described earlier, and we pass through the same exact function. So we're basically constructing this struct that holds a function that has a const generic type parameter that is computed when we compile our program, where every time we call call, it returns us a new fnn that has one less invocation call available to it than we had previously. So every time we call call, it returns us this new fnn that subtracts from the number we had previously, which then we call call on that one and it subtracts again. We call call on that one, it subtracts again. And then because this is all being computed, or the const generics are being computed at compile time, Rust will say, hey, you can't subtract from 0. And if we try to do it again and we uncomment this fourth line, that's when we get our attempt to compute an overflow, which is also why this error message is not an error message that you would find useful if you were using this function in like your regular code base, right? Like you wouldn't want to see attempt to compute 0 minus 1, which would overflow. That's why we're talking about this as a kind of exercise in using unstable features for fun, not for like production usage. And that's it. There's not much more to it. We are basically just constructing this struct. Const generics allows us to define this generic const when we construct our struct. Whenever we call it, we return a new one. And one more interesting thing to look at, I think, is that when we take this function and we actually do go to call it, we do get an ownership issue. So the struct that we've created here, this fnn, owns this function. And when it creates the new function in the next call, it moves that function into the next one. So we effectively make any copies that we've attempted to make here invalid, because you can see that we're doing the f.call here. The function that is being held in this original f is being moved to d. Thus, f doesn't have it to use anymore. And this is one of the things that Rust ownership really holds us to and really is something we can lean on when we're designing our programs. And kind of a really fun thing is that no matter how hard we try to get around these rules, even if we try to clone, clone was not implemented for this struct. So we can't actually clone this, which means that we do actually get a function that we can only call 3 times when we construct this with the const generic and the number 3 here. And that is checked for us at compile time. So this is really cool to me. I really enjoy digging into this stuff. I wouldn't use this in production though, like not this way anyway. And of course, as I'm recording this video, the author of the original code put up a second, more advanced version of it. So if you're interested in seeing more, we have more. This time we enable the fn traits and the unboxed closures nightly features. So we're using even more in progress Rust nightly code. You can see that our struct is still defined in the same way. We've still got the fnn with the const n. In this case, they've chosen to make it a usize. But we get to, by using the fn traits, remove the call function that we were defining before, because what fn traits allows us to do is implement traits like fn once or fn mute for our types. So in this case, we can see the fn once trait here. We've got an associated type called output, and we got this weird syntax you may not have seen before, extern rust call fn call once, that takes some arguments and returns an output. You're required to implement this call once function, and you're required to implement it this way. So back to our code, instead of defining that call function that we had before using fn traits, we can now define an fn once implementation for our fnn with all of the generic type arguments that we had before. Now there is some syntax here that I am unfamiliar with myself. We've got the where clause here. So we're implementing fn once, parameterized by a, the argument type, for fnn, which takes all of our generics like we had before, where fnn n minus 1 arf comma r colon nothing. So there's nothing between this semicolon and this comma, and I'm not sure what that means actually. So if you know what that means, leave it in the comments. But you can see the associated type here that we need to define for fn once, which is fnn n minus 1 arf with the return type. The return type in our case is, again, unit, so we don't really have to worry about that. And then we've got that fancy extern Rust call syntax. As far as I know, this is ABI syntax and is one of the reasons that we have to use unboxed closures in addition to fn traits. So we get to define this call once that takes a self and the arguments that we're going to pass in, which are of type A, which for us, again, is unit. And it returns the associated type output, which is the new function, the same thing we were defining to return from our call function in the previous iteration. And the code here is exactly the same. So all that's changed here is that we've enabled fn traits, we've enabled unboxed closures, and instead of defining call, we've defined an implementation of fn once for our fnn struct. But what that does is allows us to use the call syntax that we're used to using for functions. So instead of doing f.call and passing in unit, we can just call f, and on the left-hand side, it works. And if we uncomment this, you can see that we still get the exact same error. So we've got attempt to compute 0 minus 1, which is the exact same functionality that we had before, where every time we call this function, in this case with the actual function call syntax that we're used to using, we get a new one returned, and then we call it again, and we get a new one returned that is n minus 1, which is all computed at compile time because we're using const generics. So I hope you enjoyed this brief look into Nightly Rust and some unfinished features of the Rust language. I don't actually know how close any of these are to stabilizing. I think the generic consts is something that's being actively worked on and actively pushed to being shipped and stabilized in more places. But I don't know about fn traits or unboxed closures. I don't know what the status of those is. I will say that if you are interested in unstable things in the Rust language, stuff that hasn't been stabilized yet, some stuff that isn't available on the stable release of Rust, you can look at the Rust Unstable book, which will actually give you a tracking issue for the feature in question. So in this case, it's 29.625, and we can see who's working on it. We can see, let's make this a little bit bigger. You can see basically whether the RFC is approved. You can see all the tags on the GitHub issue. You can see who's working on it. You can see any kind of bugs or developments that are happening. You can see all of the previous kind of conversational history around this feature and where it could be used and what it would be useful for. So in this case, 29.625 encompasses unboxed closures here and also fn traits. But if you're interested in any of the wider set of unstable Rust, which definitely includes things that are much closer to being stabilized, as well as things that are pretty far from being stabilized, you should go check out the Unstable book, which will give you a lot more information into sort of how to enable these features, how to play with them, what each of them do. They all come with examples, which is really, really nice. And I hope you enjoyed this dive into unstable Rust. And I'll catch you in the next video. Have a great day.